Hello forever. Aloha and welcome to Hawaii. Are you having a great time? Isn't it wonderful to see all these wonderful distributors who have worked so hard for this last year to earn the trip here to receive these great bonus checks? The chairman's checks are wonderful. You want to see more of them? Okay, well, don't go to sleep. Don't leave the building, because we got more checks today. And make sure you're back here tomorrow, because they keep getting bigger and bigger and bigger. You know, I think we all have to be so thankful to God for all of the many blessings that we have and the opportunities in forever. And this trip, this week, we ought to be thankful for the sun and the warmth that we get from it. And we need to be thankful for the full moon. Did you notice this week we have a complete big full moon? Wow, is that exciting. And sure fun to be out on the beach playing in a full moon, isn't it? And then, of course, we're so fortunate to have the beautiful rains, because they bring forth beautiful flowers and wonderful fruits, and the trees look so gorgeous, and everybody loves coconut trees, right? Okay, well, we have a lot to be thankful for. You know, I heard so many people say that they took 30 hours to arrive by airplane to attend the rally, and they thought it was a long, long time. You know, we ought to be thankful for those fast airplanes that made it in 30 hours, because I know that Robert Louis Stevenson, when he came to Hawaii, it took him 3 weeks to go from San Francisco to Hawaii on his ship, on the boat that he was on. And when he went to Auckland, New Zealand, or to Sydney, it usually took maybe 3 months for him to get there. And, you know, mail only arrived by the boat. And I have to tell you that when I was in Samoa, the boat only came once a month. And so you can bet we were there to see if somebody still remembered us. Well, most of all, I want to tell you that I'm thankful for you and you and you. You're the greatest people on this earth. And you're here because you are the very best. And I want to recognize some friends of ours who have been helping us in the philanthropic problems around the world, and helping do various things that for people who are less fortunate than we. And I'd like to have Rob Smoot and his wife, Michelle, stand up if they would, where you can see them, or somebody send them out here on the stage so you can get a chance to see them. Because Rob talks to me every single day about what's happening throughout the world in tidal waves, in all of the problems that we know about, and that go through the various countries. And he spends his life helping those people. And so I hope you get a chance to meet him. Rob, where are you? Can anybody see him? From up here, we can only see a big light out there. So we'll get him to come out here on the stand, and his wife, Michelle, as soon as they can find him. Well, I wanted to tell you a little about the history of forever. Would you like to know more about history of forever? 35 years is a long time. How long can you sit here today and listen? Forever? Well, you know, it's been an incredible journey, and our successes have been fantastic. But with those successes, I have to tell you, there's been a lot of challenges. You know, it hasn't been rosy and every day. It has had its thorns and it has had the challenges. But they wouldn't need us if it wasn't any thorns for us to overcome, right? So that's what I want to talk a little about today. And the company history is not unlikely what happens to each one of you as you are building your forever business. Let me tell you about a little about forever. I won't tell you the whole thing. In the beginning, I learned in my life at home with my family on a farm in Idaho that there's not any shortcuts to work. You can't shortcut it. You have to do it right, and you have to spend the time that it takes to do it. My dad taught me hard work, moving sprinkler pipes, working from daylight to dark to get the crops planted, to combine the grains when they were ready in the fall. And I actually was able to get 2 weeks out of school every spring and every fall, 2 weeks, to be able to help with the crops, because the family needed to have the crops brought in so they could sell them and have money. My dad taught me very hard work. He always said that a lean purse is easier to cure than endure. And I'm going to tell you what that means a little. It means that if you don't like not having money to be able to buy things, the way to solve that is go work. Go do whatever you can do to earn money so that you don't have to be poor. And that goes for every one of us. And I'm sure every one of you can say that when you were growing up, that you had that same challenge, the same problems. Well, I believe in the philosophy of hard work, no shortcuts, and with it, I've had an opportunity to have some successes. That, you know, the traditional businessman working in a corporate world, so I went to college, and afterwards I worked in an accounting firm with Deloitte and Touche, and I learned how to be a corporate businessman, and I liked it, and I enjoyed it. I liked doing taxes because I knew if I was successful, I was going to have to do a lot of tax paying, and I loved to do that. I loved to see how other people did their businesses, and so for 2 years, I worked with them. Then I went the real estate business because I loved real estate. I love big buildings. I love lots of land. And I worked for many years in that and business. And that's when I got acquainted with some of my friends who were in multi-level marketing. And they were always coming to me and say, Rex, come and speak to our group on Saturday and tell them how long it took you to get to be a vice president of Del Webb Corporation, which, by the way, was the only New York Stock Exchange company in Arizona, and tell them how long it takes you to make $100,000. Give them some guidelines, because we can show them how to make more money faster. And so I'd say, if it'll help you, I'll come and do it. And so I would sit there on a Saturday and watch them put the marketing plan on the board. And I'd say, this is kind of pretty good. It's smart. It's smart marketing. It's smart helping people. And if the numbers are true, they're going to make a lot more money than I do. And so I started researching the marketing plans that were in existence at that time, and I said, I can do it better. I can do it so people make more money over a period of time, because I know and I wanted a marketing plan for what was going to last forever. And that's what we have. You know, I did what most people go out and find a product and say, I want to sell that, and they start trying to sell it, and they have a rough time, and they don't make enough money to pay the expenses. Well, I started with the marketing plan, and before I knew what kind of products I wanted to sell. And when I got the marketing plan, what I thought then was perfect, I started looking for products. And I looked at everything that was available, and I knew that I wanted to get a product that would be usable, that people would use it every day, and they would buy it every month at least, or every week. And I knew that there was no shortcuts to success. I found that out fast. And I had learned that in all my prior jobs. Anyway, as I was looking at various products, I always went back to when I was in high school. I thought I'd like to be a doctor, because I wanted to help people. And so when I went to college, I thought maybe that would be a good vocation for me to be a doctor. But when I talked to those guys that were graduating, and they told me, well, you got another 12 years of college, I said, wow, I don't think that will work. I've got a wife at home, I've got a boy, and I've got all these other things that I want to do, and I don't think I want to spend 12 more years in college. And so I went with Deloitte and Touche. I went with the Dell Webb Corporation, great companies. I learned lots, and I don't regret one day of it. But as I'm looking for the product that I needed, I ran into three doctors. They all lived in Dallas, Texas. And they had spent 25 years of their lives developing the stabilization process for aloe vera, where you could take that beautiful, clear gel out of the leaf and you could stabilize it naturally, put it in bottles, cap it, seal it so air didn't get to it, and you could keep it almost indefinitely. And I thought, wow, that is really something. You know, I only knew aloe vera to put on my sunburn when I went water skiing and got sunburn. But it was really good, but I knew it was great because it took away the sting in that. So anyway, I took some of their product. They are already bottling it, and they're trying to sell it in health food stores. Guess what? It sat there on the counter, and you could put your finger around it and dust every place because nobody knew what aloe vera was. Nobody knew what to do with it, and they weren't selling any. And you know, when I told the people at my company at Dale Webb that I was going to sell aloe vera, they said, "Aloe who?" They never even heard of it. Nobody, no wife, no mother had an aloe vera plant in their kitchen. Like today, everybody knows aloe vera all around the world. And so we were very fortunate that I said, give me some of that product to try and I'll take it to people who have ailments. And everybody that drank aloe vera said, hey, I feel better. I've the pains in my stomach are gone. My tennis elbow is working now. Everybody was happy with it. And so we started with just three products. Aloe vera juice, we called it then. Aloe vera jelly and aloe vera lotion. Three products. We started for almost the first 2 years. But guess what? It worked. Everybody that got some of it worked it, and they shared it with their friends, and pretty soon almost everybody in the United States was trying aloe vera. And I don't know how many of you are here today. I know some of you are here today that started that very first month in April of 1978, right? How many here today started with us in 1978 or 79? Will you stand up? And anybody here? And let's see who you are. I think Delma Syndergaard is here. I haven't seen her yet. Delma, you here, stand up. The Herreras. Lydia and the Herreras, I know you're here. I've seen you. The DeBones. Marco and Milagros DeBone is here. How many more are here? Can you see anybody? Well, come up afterwards, and I want to see you up here on the stand. We're going to take a picture as soon as our rally is over, so you'll be able to see them. Well, in the early years, we leased an office in Phoenix, Arizona, where I had the real estate company that I was working with, and it had a small office where we put three desks, one typewriter, and one telephone line. That's how we started forever. Is that incredible? We put labels on and stored the products in a garage in the space between my pickup and my car. We purchased aloe vera products from the doctor, and one of the three doctors, some of you have read his book, I'm sure, Bill Coates. How many of you, raise your hand if you've read one of Bill Coates' books. He was one of those three doctors. He's still alive in Dallas, but they told me this week that he's ailing, he's been sick, and he hasn't been selling very much product. But we purchased products from outside vendors who were raising aloe and trying to make products. And I found out that every month they wanted to raise the price. And if they raised the price, guess what? I had to raise the price to you. And that wasn't a very good thing. And so I went down to South Texas and looked over the aloe vera plantations, and there was only about 6 parcels of land growing aloe vera. And I knew from the very first month that we were going to be needing lots of aloe vera, and so I started buying the existing plantations. Some of them was only 1 acre, 2 acre, 5 acres, 10 acres. The largest one was 20 acres. That's all that there was growing there at that time. And I started buying them. I started buying other land that was good. And so we started planting our own aloe, so we were going to be self-sufficient. And as we went along, we wanted to do new products. And when you go to an outside vendor and tell them you want new products, they think they know everything and they want it done their way. And it was almost impossible to get high quality products. And so we started buying our own building, our own land, and we purchased our first building when we got Aloe Vera of America. Bill Coates actually had one little building of about 2,000 square feet where they were making products in Dallas. And he said, boy, we can make all this product. We can make a lot more than you can sell. And in the first 5 days, he was out of products, and we had to start building a new building of our own. We acquired his building. It was, I should have known, because the address in Dallas was Easy Street. And I can tell you, it wasn't easy. There was nothing easy about it. And it never got easier until we built a big plant and processing plant there, and in order to take care of all our business. And the reason why we've been successful is because we hired great people that are smart and knew what they were doing, and wanted to work hard, and wanted to get ahead in life. And some of those that I hired, you know, because Navaz is here today. Navaz was with me with Del Webb. She helped draw up the corporation papers. She helped do everything in getting the company started. And R.J. Lloyd, most of you know R.J., our attorney. R.J. Started with us, and he would be here today, but he had to have a little surgery done this week and yesterday, and we checked on him, and he's doing fine, and he told me to tell you all hello and looked forward to seeing you in the near future. And you know who else was with us when we started? Greg. Greg was in high school. Greg came in every day after school. You know where Greg started? Greg started out in the warehouse. He did everything for every job, every direction. When he learned how to take care of the products, make sure they got to the distributors, shipping everything that was happening, and then they moved him up to accounting. He went through every job in accounting so he would know how to do it. Pretty soon he actually graduated from high school, working part-time forever. And then he went to college, he went to Argentina for 2 years on a mission. He did everything that we needed him to do. He was a gopher for his first 10 years of his life, I think. And sometimes he still thinks he's a gopher, but you know different. You know he is really great and brilliant. And we're glad we got him. We're glad he's got all that background. We're glad he's the smartest guy in the building here. When we have problems, we go to Greg and ask him. You know, we had our first receptionist that Navaz interviewed, Judy, our receptionist still today is with us, and she was Girl Friday. She did everything else that Navaz didn't do. And so we have long-term people. We've given her a 30-year pin already, 30 years. Is that great? We purchased one building in Tempe. We had to get out of that little one-man office, three-man office. Only three people could be in at one time. And we bought a building in Tempe. And when we bought it and moved in, guess what? We found out it was too small. And so we had to rent some more space in the building next door. And then we kept growing. We were growing so fast that we were just hoping that we were shipping aloe vera and not honey or something else. But we then purchased another building in Tempe that was five times larger than the first one. And guess what? After 2 years, we found out it was too small. It's just like all the offices in all your countries. Every office we've ever had and rented or purchased, within a year or two, it's too small. Because you're doing such a great job in expanding, bringing new friends in, and we like that. And so if you haven't had a new office, a new expansion, a new addition, maybe you're not doing the program right. Remember, this is a fun business, and if you're not having fun, you might be doing something wrong, right? Okay, so if you listen to everything that you're told this week, you'll be doing the business right. Well, in 1982, we purchased Robeson Honey Bee Products. And that really expanded everything. We were now selling pollen. We were selling propolis. We were selling royal jelly. We were selling honey. And we had bees going every place. We had all the bees in Arizona going up to Grand Canyon, collecting all of the honey and all of the pollen that they could get. And it didn't take us very long to find out that we now we are buying pollen and propolis from all over the world, and honey from all over the world, and from China to Spain, and we are selling, you're selling the products that are really the very finest, and they are giving people better health, which is really good. Our international expansion started into Canada in 1980, Malaysia in 1982, in Japan in 1983. Sales, yeah, listen to those guys. But Japan was a major undertaking, and it wasn't easy at first. You know, it was like 5 years before we really got going good in there, and we worked very hard at it. Some of the people in our office asked, why would you keep pouring money into Japan to expand and to do all these things when they doesn't make a profit? Well, I told him, don't you worry. There is great potential in Japan. And Mr. Lloyd believed in it. And Mr. Gene Yamagata, Mr. Hiro Sugisawa and Mr. Rec Toma in Japan, they believed that it would grow too, and they believed in the products and they used them. And we have done very, very well in Japan, as you know, and Japan is growing, just so all of you know that, and especially you guys down there in South America. Yeah, you know that for many years they were number one seller in the world, in the countries around the world, and that you better keep growing or somebody's going to be knocking at your door and coming up behind you. And we encourage them and know that they're doing a great job. And Greg has been, our president has been put on our executive team in Japan and helping them. And we are very excited about what's happening there. We moved to our current building from Tempe. We moved to Scottsdale, Arizona in 1997. And we were in a building too small, of course. We had to put people in other buildings because we didn't have enough room for them. And so I've been looking at all the buildings around, and lo and behold, one of the banks consolidated, sold out to Wells Fargo, and their main building was available. And so we negotiated with them. We were able to buy the building, and the great thing about it was the bank that we had been using for our resorts, and we had a couple of loans with them on resorts over in Las Vegas on the Lake Mead. And they called us up one day and said, hey, we've got too many loans out. The government's telling us we've got to get rid of some of the loans, and so we're calling all our loans in, and we're going to call your loans, and you're going to have to pay it off. And we went down and sat down with them and said, hey, we've had loans with you on our resorts now for some almost 10 years, and we've paid every month, every quarter, every year. We've made the payments, never missed a one. And they said, we're sorry, we can't do it. So we kind of stomped out of the bank and said, well, tough luck. We'll go to somebody else. We did. We then went back to them the day after we bought our new building in Scottsdale, Arizona. And we walked in to the president of the bank and we said, we're your new landlord. We're here to tell you that you're going to do business our way. And all the desks, all the pencils, everything here is ours. You're just renting it. So it was very fun for us. It was very fun to be able to do that. And so at that time I said, I don't want any loans. I don't want any more debt. And if we can't pay cash for it, we don't want to buy it. And so that's the way we've been ever since that time. And I also learned another thing. I learned that never burn your bridges. Always be careful of how you treat other people on the way up, because you'll probably meet them again on the way down. And so that was a good one for us. 1998, we're still growing and expanding into all the countries. And our sales topped $1 billion at that time. We continued to build our executives group and our worldwide leadership team that you guys know. And one thing we learned, that successful business is never a one-man operation. And especially in forever, you need to work together as a team. You need to help each other. You need to encourage each other, because sometimes it just gets downright hard to keep going every day with all of the people throwing things at you. Today, we have a new 280,000 square foot facility in Ava, in Dallas, in Aloe Vera of America. When I say Ava, it's Aloe Vera of America, who makes our products. And they do more than eight million gallons of aloe vera annually. 8 million gallons annually. Is that a lot of aloe? Man, you could swim for months in that much aloe, couldn't you? Now, remember that we started on Easy Street with only 2,000 square feet of the building. We just last year built a new nutraceutical 80,000 square foot building. And in Phoenix, Arizona, where we do all our tableting, all our pollens, all our propolis and royal jellies and Arctic Seas and everything we do there at Nutraceuticals in Phoenix. And we are just finished this spring, the first of the year, a new 80,000 square foot, 300,000 square foot building in Amsterdam, Netherlands. And where's the Netherlands group? Yeah, we're going to be over to see them next month. Maybe in about 2 weeks, we're going to have the grand opening in Netherlands for our new beautiful building, and it is fantastic, and it's state-of-the-art. Everything is automatic, like we have in Dallas, where the robots are doing everything, and the people are just watching them to make sure they don't get out of line. Now, we own more than 6,000 acres of aloe vera plantations in the Dominican Republic, many also down in South Texas by McAllen, and we take aloe from them every week and use it for our great products. And we are now at something new for you. We're now doing business in 155 foreign countries. And I hope you realize there's only 195 countries around the world. But we got a lot to go. But that doesn't mean anything, because just think, in each of your countries, there's so many people. Most people have never heard of forever. Most people have never had a glass of real aloe. And so we have our job to do and things to do. We got major internet presence. We have 175,000 fans on our Facebook. We have more than 5 million people visit foreverliving.com last year. 5 million people. How about that? We have many giving, forever giving projects, like we just did here today with the two groups, to help their organizations help people who are needy and less fortunate than us. What's next? What are we going to do next? We got new people like Greg involved to take us to the maximum, to be first in line with all the great things. Our Eagle Manager Program is building our next generation of distributors leadership, our future 20K distributors. We're going to continue to create the world's greatest products, new products. You like our new products? We're going to continue to expand into new countries as the opportunities present them. A lot of those other countries that we're not in, you know, they have some bad eggs there, and they have a lot of wars and rumors of wars going on. And so we don't want our distributors to be involved in those, but we'll be there soon. And so we're going to continue this year to help you get into all of the people, get the products to all the people in your countries, wherever they might live, even the smaller cities and towns. Well, the key lessons I've learned that over these last 35 years is that you gotta sponsor and work with the best people. People that are so negative that they don't wanna listen and they don't wanna do what you ask them, don't waste your time with them. Someday they'll change. Sponsor and work with the best people. That'll help you get to the top fastest. Build it right, and don't try to shortcut it. And remember the movie, if you build it, they'll come. We're gonna build it, and we know you're gonna come with new people. Gain control of the process in your business, and build for the long haul. Create a long-term strategy, not short-term gains like other countries, other companies have. We're in it for the long haul. And most importantly, smile. Remember what Greg told us? Smile, smile. Attitude is everything. Positive thinking is contagious. Be a positive thinker, and people will want to be a part of you if you make it fun. Remember, our business is a fun business. Wear your pins. And remember I told you about Lay's, how they're so important in Hawaii, in Samoa, in all the other countries in the Pacific, and other countries around the world use Lay's. Wear them with pride. Make sure you take them home and tell people, tell all your downline people what a Lay's about, what the people do. It helps them be together. It helps them work together because they're all wearing the same Lay's, and they all are shooting for the same pins. And so remember to wear your pin and be working towards your next level, because that's important for you to get bigger checks. Well, remember that I've told you 100,000 times, the power of forever is the power of love. I love you all. I am Rex. I love you all, and I am forever with a smile. Thank you.
Rex, thank you so much. Please welcome to the stage, Miss Ruth Maughan. Come on, guys, a big round of applause for the lady that's been behind all of that, that supported Rex through all of those years of challenge and struggle. And guess what, Rex? Look behind us. Remember, it's our birthday. Our 35th birthday. Congratulations, Rex, Ruth. And I wonder if you guys want to join us in singing happy birthday to these great people. Can you help me with that? Okay, ready? And you know my voice is terrible. So I apologize up front. But on behalf of all of us, we want to thank you both
from the bottom of our hearts for sacrificing so much, enable us to have such an opportunity 35 years later. We appreciate it. Do we appreciate it? Okay, ready? We have to do the English version. One, two, three. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear forever. Happy birthday to you.